If you've ever had to babysit your neighbor's demon child while simultaneously playing a game of croquet, you've essentially driven the 2018 Nissan GT-R GT3 car. Even though this thing looks absolutely stunning, sounds heavenly, and is taller than the Empire State Building, there are quite a few quirks, let's say. Today we're looking at Godzilla himself. Before we get started, I want to mention that this is part of a video series where I go through every GT3 car in Assetto Corsa and Competizione, and if you want to see more, you can click on the card in the upper right corner that takes you to a playlist with all the other videos in this series. I'd also super appreciate it if you hit the subscribe button and like the video, it really helps me out. Alright, let's understeer our way into this. The 2018 Nissan GT-R GT3 is a continuation from the 2015 GT-R, which featured quite a lot of design changes. The biggest and most impactful change was moving the engine placement more rearwards as well as lower, both by 150mm. This was Nissan's attempt at correcting the hilariously not so good weight distribution of the 2015 car, which, to be fair, it actually did improve quite a bit. By the way, I'm pulling these numbers from the Nismo Customer Racing website, which I'll have linked in the description. It's actually a pretty nifty page. It has every single stat about the GTR. It's pretty cool. The 2018 GTR puts out a tasty 540-ish horsepower at 6,500 RPM, depending on BOP, of course, along with 637 Nm of torque at 5,000 RPM. The GTR is also just about as heavy as the McLaren 720S GT3. While being much taller and with a much wider wheelbase. So, in context as to how monstrous this thing is, it's pretty lightweight, pretty pog. In a development driver interview, Michael Crum had described the 2018 GTR to have greatly improved high-speed corner stability, and that previous models had a tendency to understeer at mid-corner. I assume he's saying the 2018 GTR has good high-speed stability because he has actual professional engineers to set up the car. I say that because whenever I try to get the GTR to do anything other than go straight at a decent pace, I can't. I swear on Godzilla's name, the GTR and ACC on any of the default setups is gonna make me go insane. It understeers more than a school bus driving over a 6-inch thick patch of ice. However, if you have the patience to properly set the car up, which mainly consists of a lot of anti-roll bar and suspension adjustments, you'll find the GTR can actually feel really good. It won't feel like it's on rails like some other cars, but the big thing is it gives you a sense of potential. Remember that word. Potential. Now, in my former school years, being told I had a lot of potential was pretty nice to hear, but sometimes it made me shut down with crippling anxiety that I have yet to get over. And the GTR is a pretty good representation of this. Remember, potential. Once you start to get more of a feel of how much pace the car actually does have, which is more than you think, you'll start to push harder, better, faster, and stronger, as any natural Daft Punk sim racing fan. Once you start getting to what you imagine the car's limit would be, you'll notice you've either completely screwed the tires, or you'll realize that you're in a wall and you're wondering what the heck kind of potential I was talking about. The thing is, the GTR is almost always having an identity crisis. As it gains pace and you start to realize there actually is potential in the car to be at the front of the field, it'll recoil back in an anxiety attack and you're left wondering if you're still driving a modern GT3 car with the amount of understeer and snap oversteer it all of a sudden gives you. In order to drive this car quickly, never mention the word potential in front of it. Nah, I'm just kidding. But you do kind of have to drive the GTR slowly. If you start to feel like you're really pushing, you're already overdriving the car. If you keep this in mind, you'll not only find that the car is actually balanced quite well, you'll also find that Godzilla's got some pace. While it does struggle at tracks with higher speed sections, mostly Silverstone, it more than shines at tighter and more technical tracks. Don't even get me started on how this thing is at British GT tracks. It is so quick there. My two personal favorite tracks to drive the GTR on is Oulton Park and Laguna Seca. If you haven't tried it at those two yet, definitely do. It gives the Porsche a run for its money. Admittedly, my most favorite thing about the GTR is the aesthetic. Good lord does it look good. And goodness gracious does it sound good. And shiver me timbers does the wheel and dash look absolutely fantastic. And butter me up and call me a biscuit, the view you have looking out in the cockpit cam is one of the best in the game. The 2018 GTR won't consistently top the timesheets at every track, but it's nowhere near the worst car either. It's a solid mid-pack car that has potential to get to the top step of the podium. It just takes a lot of work and patience to get it there. If you haven't given the GTR a shot yet, I'd recommend it. Just be sure to have a bit more patience than you think you need. Either way, you'll be in one of the best looking cars on the grid. That's the only thing that matters, right? That's it for this one, fellas, and if there's any GT3 cars that I haven't reviewed yet that you want to see, let me know in the comments. I also want to let you know that I do stream on Twitch almost every day, and I host a lot of community events for ACC. It's a lot of fun, and I'd love to see you over there. The link for that's in the description. I'll see you in the next one. Have a good one.